Welcome to Wowism, where we advocate and support spiritual literacy, true spiritual literacy. That's what this is all about. And only this really will work for you. And we say the practice that we practice is full stop in the wow. And what is the wow? A wow is when you get a glimpse of your freedom. And you realize, hey, it's not really structured. It's not structured. You see beyond structure for just a glimpse in just some little way. And it's just wow. There's an inner wow that comes up through these little glimpses. And what we practice is then full stop in that wow. Now, I had a huge wow last night. So much so that I didn't sleep very much, and I had to do intense effort to meditation, a full stop in the wow. And if you want to know religiously what is said here, really we refer to the Holy Spirit, which is the one that clarifies for us. Spiritual literacy tells us what is spiritual literacy. Now, the Holy Spirit is often associated with Jesus. And keep in mind that Jesus, the first time Jesus came, he basically said to everyone, look, to paraphrase, you're not going to really understand what I'm telling you right now. You're looking through a glass darkly. You know, you're muddled, you're confused, you're basically fear-based. Your thinking and thoughts are fear-based, so you're going to distort what I have to say. Nobody really gets it, so I'm speaking in allegories, parables, you know, not directly. And he says, I'm going to leave, and I'm going to send the Holy Spirit to you, and the Holy Spirit will work with you, and clarify for you everything that you need to know. The Holy Spirit will clarify for you. So then later, when I return, I will be able to speak directly to you, and you'll be able to see what it is I'm really talking about. Okay. So, as far as religious, spiritual identification, if we're thinking of help, pray to the Holy Spirit, ask the Holy Spirit for clarification. And the Holy Spirit has quite a sense of humor, I found. And that happened today, and I'll tell you about it. After this tumultuous morning and evening last night, and I'm not going to say exactly what happened, because I don't want to try to delineate conceptually what it is that, you know, what is essence, for example, what is essence, what is light, what is spirit, because we'll get a conceptual framework of it, a structure, and then we'll try to see that structure. What happened was, for me, basically, was I saw past structure. I saw past the structure of the body. I saw past structure of the body to spirit, to no structure. But, you know, I didn't have a mental construct of anything. It just happened. And I was just, wow. You know, just stunning. It just, wow. But I used all the discipline that I you know, have developed in practicing. And by the way, if you want to become more spiritually literate, then try to help the world become more spiritually literate, which is what I've tried to do in this lifetime. And this will, you know, this will bring you up. This is how you're brought up. You know, you'll help bring you up. If you really want to have, you know, get your spiritual literacy up to this point, full stop in the wow, where you can see beyond the illusion of structure, even the structure of the body, human body. Trying to help others. Well, it's like a teacher planning for the classroom. How can I teach the students in the classroom? What can I do to help them? So you have to be very clear, so it brings out the best in you. And I had this huge, anyway, Holy Spirit. Okay, so after this tumultuous, wow, and using tremendous will to try and stay poised, and it's still reverberating, and I fortunately haven't talked it away. I stayed away from that. I said, no, let's not try and attach labels and structure to this. Let's just stay with the wow. That's what I mean, full stop in the wow. Don't try to attach structure to it, okay? Because then you go crawling right back into that dark pit of, imaginary pit of hell and death, actually. You see, what we are, what reality is, has no structure at all. We're total, perfect freedom has, absolute freedom has no structure. It's always free. How can it have structure? It cannot. When we imagine ourselves to have structure, obviously that's false, and we're still free. And so we're going to drop, in our play with freedom, we're going to set that aside at our play. So when we believe that what we are is structure, we believe that somehow there's something within us that's going to kill us, or we're going to die. We bring about the fear of our own annihilation when we believe that we have some sort of structure, which is, Jesus calls it valuing. He says, you must drop your valuing. Valuing has to do with time, space, process, and form and structure. Okay, so I was definitely blown away by what happened last night, to the point where I couldn't even talk about it. It's just a wow. And then today, very tired. Couldn't sleep, woke up early, couldn't sleep. And I'm driving all day in hectic, dangerous conditions, and so I'm feeling very just so tired, so worn out. And in emergencies, I have this can of Red Bull. Okay, Red Bull. And I'm thinking, oh my gosh, you know, I think I'm just gonna like suddenly go unconscious here, and can I drive? I'm so tired, I'm so stressed out. So I decide that, you know, I think I better start drinking some Red Bull. I think I've only done that once before. I know it's very nasty, strong stuff, actually. After I drank one time, I said, never again. But I thought that this might be a situation where I need emergency measures. So what did I do? I asked the Holy Spirit. I said, Holy Spirit, tell me what to do. Tell me what to do. I need your guidance on this. And that's it. This is the prayer. I just prayed this. So I'm driving along the freeway. And right after I said that, okay, this truck passes me on the left. And kind of then sort of going the same speed on the freeway. And so, okay, the Holy Spirit, I sort of felt like, let me look at this truck. In the back of the truck window, the cab of the truck, there was these decals. So I just say, let me read this decal, you know. And I read the decal, and it says, don't do it. Don't do it. That was the decal. Right after I prayed, I really need to make guidance on this. It said, don't do it. I said, thank you, Holy Spirit. Okay. And I didn't do it. And somehow, I was just able to, with enthusiasm, somehow, you know, get some energy and shake off this extreme tiredness, sleepiness, and was able to push through it without any artificial aid there like that. So this is just one little tiny example of the humor of the Holy Spirit. You know, it uses everything to help us. There's nothing that it can't use to get our attention. And so, whatever it is that is going to work for us, it will somehow, I don't know how it Holy Spirit manages, it's quite extraordinary, to say the least. What's the odds? I've never seen this decal. Don't do it. That's all it said. Don't do it. And that's exactly what I was asking for. Should I do it or not do it? And here it was, don't do it. Fantastic. Now, I've talked a lot about the world situation. It's very, very simple. Our situation's very, very simple, actually. And as we go towards January 1st, 2015, what we're doing is we're getting into focus, very clearly into focus. Our situation, what is our situation? Our situation is very simple. We're afraid of no structure. That's it. And what we are is it doesn't have any structure. We're spirit. We're free. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit as God created me. I'm absolute freedom. Absolute freedom doesn't have any structure. Another way to put it, it has all structure, but has no real, no structure at all, because it's completely free always. You can't say that what we are has any structure to it, okay? And that's what we're afraid of, because we have tried to change and give ourselves structure to prove that we can change the will of God. And so we have believed that we have structure. And so to give up this belief in structure, we think is our annihilation. And so we have a very severe continuity fear to go from the belief in that what we are has structure to accepting that what we are doesn't have any structure at all. In fact, nothing, reality doesn't have structure. This is called the continuity fear. So it's very simple. We're afraid, we have this severe continuity fear. We're afraid of going from the belief in structure to realizing we have no structure. That's it. It's that simple. The whole ball of wax in a simple realization like this. This is the only thing we struggle with. We simply struggle with this continuity fear of going from belief in structure to accepting the fact that we don't have any structure and never will. And it's very, very difficult for us. The fear is very extreme in us, extraordinarily extreme. So all of us, without exception, struggle with this. And we make all sorts of compromises. We hope, we think, well, let me just find good structure, you know, or let me get rid of the bad structure so I'm left with the good structure. It's like that. It's like saying, we pray to Jesus, Jesus, come back to earth and get rid of all the bad structure here, you know, just so we have just the good structure, and then we'll be happy with structure, things like that. Or we pray to the goddess and say, goddess, just make it so that we can have both a co-reality, one of structure, worlds, bodies, okay, and one of no structure, which is some abstract reality. Let's have both, you know, that kind of thing. So our continuity fear causes us to choose to make these efforts to compromise. But what we are has absolutely no structure. There's no compromise possible with that. You can't have structure and not have any structure. It's not possible. As far as our being, as far as being goes, absolute freedom cannot have structure. It can't have both have structure and not have structure. This is absolutely key. To say it has both structure and no structure is what's called dualism. This is our delusion. And innumerable are the ways in which we try to fool ourselves into some sort of compromise and think that this is it. Innumerable. And I speak for myself as well as my observations of the world. This is so. And so, you know, do not. And what are we supposed to do? Forgive ourselves. Forgive ourselves. Understand just a continuity fear. And just forgive ourselves for all these compromise efforts that we have engaged in. And, okay, it hasn't hurt what we are at all. Not at all. It hasn't changed our perfect freedom at all. So it's had no effect on what we are at all. Jesus says, forgive yourself. That's it. Forgive yourself for engaging in all these compromise efforts, which we have all done. So we're not judgmental towards people. When I point out stuff, it's not from the standpoint of judgmentally saying that you're bad or evil. It's saying this is a compromise effort. It won't work. Let it go and forgive yourself. Forgive yourself. Let it go. And keep evaporating the continuity fear. Keep evaporating the continuity fear. Because if you want to ask, well, what kind of success will this give you? A lot of success. Just like last night, where I had a tremendous experience. It was due to working on this wow, full stop in the wow. Don't let the mind throw structure into it. Just try to stay free of structure, free of the past, present, future. Don't let the mind start putting structure into it. And you just watch the mind say, no, not that. And the mind keeps coming back in so many creative ways. This compromise, that compromise, this. And you say, no. And just practicing no to all these compromises. This is the full stop in the wow. like, wow, I just see what I am has no structure. I am. Just that's not I am this or I am that. It's just I am. That's all. Just I am. I am what all experiences potentially, but no experience in particular. Okay? No, nothing defines what we are. We are undefinable. We are absolutely undefinable what we are. We are absolute essence that's everywhere, every when, every what, which is completely undefinable. Indefinable. I don't know. Whatever it is, it's not definable. And so, when we try to define what we are, we're imagining our own annihilation, actually, because we identify with that, and that's not it at all. I mean, so, you know, it's like wow, letting go of that is like, well, I'll cease to exist, you know. But I have to let go of it because it's not it. Nothing is it. There is no definition for us. What's for absolute freedom without any exception, no exceptions, no exemptions whatsoever. So, what I did was I looked a little deeper. What happened was I decided to look a little deeper, and in seeing that, I suddenly shifted perception somehow, and mentally, in a subtle way, and then I saw, oh wow. So it's easy, it's easy. We can just, it was just a little effort that I made. I sort of made this little effort. I just want to make this effort. And then suddenly I saw it differently than I've seen before. And it was a real stunner. I just immediately went into, okay, full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow. And just, you know, started to get used to it, that's all. Just say, okay, let's start to get familiar with this. I know there's a big backlash of continuity fear here. Fine. Let's just let this settle down and just continue on with the same practice that we're doing right here in the videos. So when you get more familiar, the more you practice this, actually practice it, full stop in the wow. Catch the wow moments. Be looking for the wow moments, and then full stop, and then watch your mind, and don't let your mind throw structure in there. Okay? And you'll... I caught so many, 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 many attempts to throw structure into them, to wrap it up in structure. And I said, no, not that. No, not that. Not now, maybe later. You say, okay, no, not that. Not now, maybe later. I'm full stopped in the wow of this, so not now, maybe later. You know, say that to the structure. Not now, maybe later. Okay, because the continuity fear, we don't want to say never. That'll freak us out. Say, not now, maybe later. So this is the essence of spiritual literacy, actually. This is the essence of it. And the wow was still with me. There's no question. It was a watershed sort of event. But you know, it didn't freak me out too much at all. But it was like, oh, hey, wow, that's really something. I mean, that's great. You know, oh, it's really profound, very profound. So there is something very profound that we can see. But we won't dare to do it until we feel comfortable that, you know what, I can just have this full stop in the wow practice. I won't try to throw too much structure around it. Otherwise, if you don't practice this and you manage to force some sort of glimpse, you're going to get a reaction formation from this being stunned so badly, and you're going to throw some sort of structure. Your mind is going to wrap this experience up in some sort of structure. Jesus says all thinking is of the past, meaning some experience you had of essence where you've wrapped it up in structure. Some experience of no structure, structure freeness, frightened, and you wrap it up in structure. And these are our thoughts, this is our thinking. He says, all thinking is of the past. It's all has to do with an explain. Is an attempt to define what we are, essence, the experiencing of essence. We're trying to define it. And he says, you can't. And so it's just like our life is so crummy. Our life is so crummy. Because we're trying to live according to some way of symbolizing, representing, defining actual experience. And he says, you cannot do that. You absolutely cannot do it. So when you have a wow, don't try to define it. You'll know it. You say, wow. Okay. Just then watch your mind and don't let the mind start putting packaging on that experience. Don't let the experience be packaged for you. So is there some breakthroughs for us? Oh, absolutely, there are breakthroughs, and when you prepare for them by disciplining your mind, for sure. I'm still shocked by it. There's no question. So it takes patience to get used to it. But it will bring about a change in how you're able to interact with the world. The scare tactics don't work so well anymore on you. All sorts of new ways of responding to the world have occurred to me, which before it hadn't occurred to me. And those come through in the videos. More of an absolute abstract. But it takes a while to change your responses to in our situation. It takes a while. And why? Because we're afraid that if we really stand up for freedom, that the world threatens us, that it'll catapult us into freedom. You say, oh, you want freedom? Okay, here, as if they could force it upon us. No one can force anything upon anyone. So nobody can force freedom on you. Not even God can force freedom upon you. It's in terms of dropping this delusion of lack of freedom. No, God doesn't need to force freedom on us because God knows we're already free. Okay? But nobody can force an experience upon us that we don't want, that we don't choose, that we don't agree. Yes, okay, I agree, I will have that experience. So nobody can catapult us into freedom, and yet they threaten us with that. Whereas if we stand up for spiritual literacy and truth in this world, what happens, the world, the backlash, the continuity fear of the world will express itself as saying, oh, okay, well, since you want freedom, we're gonna push you into freedom. And then that'll frighten you. If you haven't already worked through your continuity fear, you'll say, no. And then you will end up developing structure, throwing a whole bunch of structure around what you believe yourself to be. So one of the benefits of losing your continuity fear is you cannot be threatened. Scare tactics cannot be used so effectively on you anymore. Now, I was looking for something. I said, you know, I need to take the next step. What is it? I was looking for it. And there was. Wow. Okay. So, seek and ye shall find. And it's just a matter now of normalizing it for myself, feeling comfortable, familiar. And saying, yeah, okay. the world, okay? We're not forgetting about the world here, okay? Not that there is a world, there actually isn't, because we're absolutely free. All is absolutely free. Spirit is absolutely free. So you can never say that there is a world. There is a experience as something definite. It's just the appearance of this moment of light, as light appearing as this moment. It's not attached to the next moment at all. So you can't really talk about things. Actually, there are no things, technically speaking, at all. So there's really, technically speaking, there is no world at all. But because of the continuity fear we have, we certainly understand this, that we're afraid of realizing this. But we have to go towards realization, go towards acceptance. We have to. And the problem the world is right now is the continuity fear can be very severe. Okay, very, very severe. And you can actually make it worse and worse and worse. And there are those who have made it very bad for themselves. So much so that they think that the salvation is just to develop absolute confusion. So you have no idea of what to do in terms of applying your mind towards evaporating the continuity fear. You can't even consider this. It's just, you know, what I call total spiritual illiteracy is the goal of these folks who are so frightened because they pursued the idea of being greater than God to such an extent that this is the result. And there's no knock on them. It means that they were very adventurous, which we all are. And they thought they'd just have a great time, which we all did. And so, they just happen to now be stuck with the severe continuity fear, you know, real bad, and they need to work through it, which they will eventually. But right now, they're not quite ready to do so. For those who are not quite ready to do so, they become an extraordinarily troublesome to those who are ready to do so and willing and are doing it. They can become extraordinarily troublesome because they can demand that everybody share their confusion. That's just what they demand. They want total compliance with sharing their confusion, sharing their spiritual illiteracy. And they believe if everybody shares spiritual illiteracy, we'll all be in nirvana, all our problems gone, we'll all be happy because we're all on the same page of what? Confusion. So they say if we're all equally confused, problem solved, they say. Why? Because there's no one clear enough to point out what the two options we have, duality or non-duality, and the fact we have to choose, realize that non-duality is truth, and we must set down duality. There's nobody there to explain it, no clarity. And no clarity from within because we're blocking with confusion. So they say, hey, problem solved. It's not solved. But they believe this is the solution. Everyone share equal confusion. All have equal confusion, hold hands, and kingdom of heaven on earth, peace on earth, everything solved, problem solved. The opposite is happens actually. Makes things much, 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 much worse. Now, this world we're in right now, the situation we're in right now in this world is a situation where a whole lot of folks, spirits, who have this idea of let's just all have equal confusion, and that's going to be the great answer everyone's been searching for. There's a tremendous amount of spirits that believe in this in this world at this time. It's a very dark age, like the very bottom of the bottom of spiritual darkness is going on here, and they are working very aggressively to what I call is collapse the world into compliance. This is very key. Collapse the world into compliance. There is an analogy. Let's say there's a house that's made of wood and the termites get into it and they're eating the foundation of wood. Everything's wood. And they just, you know, absolutely turn it into just and pretty much empty space in sight is what they do. It reminds me, I mean, there's no wood left in sight. But if you look at the house externally, the surface only, you don't see it. You don't see the termites. They don't go through to the surface very much. A little bit here and there to drop their droppings or something. But you can look at a house and not even see it and think, oh, the house is fine, no problem. But over the years, the termites will decimate a house if they're not treated. It's not treated. And the house will still be standing, right? But there's really no structural support left. And what happens if like an earthquake happens, okay? Or a tornado, a hurricane or an earthquake, something really shakes up the house, all right? What happens, the house is going to collapse, is what's going to happen. So you can be living in this house unaware of the termites, or at least maybe you'll notice some termite droppings, you know, say, we got some termites probably, but I'm not gonna do anything about it. Not realizing just how bad termites can be. I mean, you can take a beam that termites have eaten that would weigh hundreds of pounds, and you can pick it up and it's just like, almost like a feather. It's got no weight to it at all. It's all gone. It's all gone. They ate it all. So this world is like a house that made of wood that has been termited. Okay, many, many, many termites came into this world and have been quite assiduously, aggressively eating away at our spiritual will. Our spiritual will towards literacy, spiritual literacy in this world. In many, 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 many ways they've been eating away at it. And so we may look at the world and say, no, everything's fine here. You know, everything's still standing. But what happens if there's some really earth-shaking event? Okay. Spiritual will collapses. Spiritual will collapses. Spiritual will towards spiritual literacy collapses into what I call compliance, which is what this idea of let's all share equal confusion, and this is going to be our salvation. So if you know, if you're a termite expert and you look at a house, say, hey, wait a minute, you know, this house is infested with termites, and you start checking around, you go under the foundation, you check your, and you say, hey, you know, this house should be red flagged because it's structurally unstable because it's got such a bad termite problem. If you're an expert on that, you can tell easily, right? Well, if you're an expert on a world being termited and you pay attention, observe, and say, hey, wait a minute, you know, this world should be red flagged. It's ready to collapse into compliance with let's all share equal confusion. It's ready to go. I mean, all it takes is some sort of event, boom, it collapses. I mean, eventually it's going to collapse on its own weight structurally, but it can be collapsed quicker than that through some pressure on it. Now, what I say is the starting with the new year coming, not some hard start, you know, I mean, it may already be starting. I mean, the furor in this world right now is just increasing, isn't it? It's absolutely increasing. The pressure on the world to collapse into confusion. About what? Spiritual truth, of course. Confusion, thinking that, oh, I am the body, thinking that we're the body, that this world is our home, and there's nothing else. This is it. Okay, this is severe confusion. Extreme confusion. When you think you're the body, and the world is real, and this is your home, and all that, and you believe in time, space, process, and form without even questioning it, then you're in a state of actually extreme confusion. Extreme confusion. Confused about what you are, confused about reality, confused about the way all is. Severe confusion. So you're not even questioning it. So most people in this world are not even questioning the situation, you know, our beliefs, not even questioning it. And some are questioning it, okay, but they're under pressure to drop this questioning. And the pressure comes from many, 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 many angles, okay? Now, if you're being chased by a lynch mob, are you going to say, huh, I wonder how many people are in this lynch mob? Let me count. How many? I want to get an accurate counting. So, you know, I wonder what their names are. I wonder what their occupations are. I wonder what their ages are. I wonder what clothes they're wearing. Are you going to do that? Or are you going to say, hey, I wonder where safety is? This is a question, right? And of course, the answer is self-evident. So, the idea of like, I'm supposed to give chapter and verse on all these different angles. There's a lynch mob after spiritual literacy in this world. I'm not going to take the time to supply all the details about each and every angle. There's innumerable angles. There's an angry lynch mob chasing us, and the focus is get to safety. That's the only focus there is. Protect your spiritual literacy. Protect it. Enhance it. The best way to protect it is enhance it. That is for sure. I can feel that experience I had is still with me. It is with me. I believe it's going to be with me permanently, actually. It really affected me at a deep level, very much at a deep level. So it feels like it will stay with me. Much like previous experiences and breakthroughs. So this is a way of enhance your spiritual literacy. So you're very clear about what your problem is. What's your problem? Continuity fear. What's the continuity fear? I'm afraid of going from the belief that I'm in structure to realizing there is no structure. It's that simple. How do you do this? Full stop in the wow. As you gradually go towards no structure, it produces this wow. You know, it's like, wow, what about the structure? No structure, or less structure, less belief in structure, you know, less and less and less belief. Wow. Or just a moment with no structure, and then, Am I okay? How's my structure? You know, but we say no. Full stop in the wow. We're not really checking in with our structure too much. Just a little bit. The body's okay. I mean, everything's fine. Okay, but not. Just say okay. Let me just sit quietly here and realize everything's okay. Everything's. I'm not catapulted into no structure. Even though I glimpse no structure, I'm not catapulted into it. Okay, so God is not trying to force anything. No structure realization upon me. Because God knows that it's already the case, actually. It's already the case. The dreamer who's dreaming a dream of structure doesn't, God doesn't need to wake the dreamer up and say, hey, stop dreaming of no structure, otherwise it's going to cause structure. No, God knows the dream of structure is not going to cause any structure at all in reality. So God is not frantically saying, fearful of our dream and saying, you got to wake up, I'm scared of your dream. No, God says, I'm not at all scared of your dream, and neither are you really. So, let's have a nice, gentle waking up from this, and so the fear can be dissipated, and forgive yourself for dreaming this dream, and all is well. This is spiritual literacy. What's happening in the world is the confusion, there's a drive for equal confusion. Lowest common denominator. Have you noticed? So many ways examples are being used for this lowest common denominator. If we all just get down to this level of confusion, everything will be great. This is happening everywhere, isn't it? Everywhere. Where are our role models, actually? The great role models. They're being forgotten to a large extent, aren't they? And what was being substituted for our role models is just these people who are in severe confusion, actually. If you look at these celebrities, these people, you look at them, just say, hey, ask yourself, is this someone who's shining with clarity about they have no structure? There is no structure. Can you see just the presence, the shining from them of like no structure, and they're perfectly abiding in this? Is that what you're seeing? Or do you see someone who's tormented with confusion and difficulty, and you know, you can see? And yet, these are the role models that we're being told to follow, is follow role models of confusion, is what we're being fed by those who have this very severe continuity fear. They're unrepentant, meaning they refuse to admit that they have a continuity fear. They say, no, we can change God. We can change our functionality. We can be greater than God. We can make structure our co-identity. You know, either they say co-identity, but ultimately they say we can make it our new real identity structure. And so we don't have any continuity fear. We can push this through. Those are called the unrepentant ones. The ones who repented, who realize the mistake they've made, and they said, wow, I can't push this through. I cannot change reality. Those are the repentant ones. The ones who say, I cannot change reality. I cannot make reality structured in any way. They have repented. In their minds, they realized this is a mistake that I made, a silly whim, and now I have a continuity problem, obviously, because I'm so used to this belief I'm structured. You know, letting it go like instantly is too much. So if we can't, so if anyone is listening, if you cannot drop structure, all structure, including even thoughts of no structure, instantly, this instant, then you have a continuity problem. It's that simple. It's absolute proof of a continuity problem. And then you get to work on the continuity problem. You realize what the problem really is. And you stop trying to enhance structure, you know, make the world peaceful, wonderful, beautiful, enhance the structure of the world. So we say, look at this. I don't want to set this down. Structure. I love structure. I'm attracted to structure. That's how you tend to go in that direction of let's get more and more and more beautiful gowns, you know, and dresses and fashion and models and all this stuff, and let's have everybody be a model in the world. Let's turn all the world into fashion models, and you know, let's glorify the body, and let's make the world look so beautiful and attractive, and let's, you know, celebrate this. And that's what happens. You get pulled towards trying to beautify structure, so you think that you just stay there forever. You don't have any problem with, you know, the continuity problems not bothering you because you're not going back to structure, you know, structure freeness. You're not going back there, you think. So this is what happens. This is what happens. And this isn't just theory. It's both theory and experiencing, direct experiencing of all this. You know, the goddess will just say, oh, come on. The problem is that you just don't, there's not enough flowers in the world. Let's put some more flowers in the world. You know, that'll solve your problem. Yeah. You just don't like the fashions we're wearing. Okay, we'll wear more beautiful fashions. Put some flowers in our fashions, flowers in our hair. Okay, let's call it good, right? Now you're happy. And we go on and on and on and on and on this way. Let's make structure more beautiful. Let's make process more beautiful, you know. Let's make these special relationships with time, space, process, form, with structure more beautiful. Special relationships are talking about relating with valuing with structure. Say this structure is attracted to this structure, and we call this love. You know, love is the it's hate. It's hate, actually. It's fear, fearful hate. Each one is feeling the other one is causing their death, you know, is projecting this onto someone else. And say they're the cause of my feeling of death. When it's really valuing of structure is the cause of the fear of death. And so this is the world, way the world is going now. You know? And to turn that around, I say culture of monasticism. Okay, monastic culture. What does this mean? Does it mean everybody are renunciates in isolation and in monasteries, nunneries, or whatever? No. It means that some are, who are far enough along that this is beneficial to them. But what it means is the rest of culture supports this and puts this as the pinnacle and says this is valuable, actually. This has some pragmatic value, not absolute value, but pragmatic value in dropping all valuing, which is what we have to do. And so those who are, you know, monastics and renunciates, etc., are appreciated by the culture. And the culture supports this, supports them, supports this, and respect, love, respect, realizing it's helping everyone. It's helping everyone. That's a spiritual culture. Is the people say thank you to those who are going, dropping their valuing, working at it intensely. They know this is trickling down to them. It is trickling down to them. As benefiting them greatly, actually helping them move towards dropping their value, helping evaporate the continuity fear. So monastic culture is the whole culture. At the pinnacle of the culture is monasticism, renuncia monasticism. In most cases, there's some also householder situations can be very revered where it can also be a householder and be sort of within that context, be a renunciate also. Don't have to be in seclusion. Do not have to be in seclusion. This is held up as the ideal. These are held up as role models. The saints are held up as role models for the whole culture. This is what's called to be a monastic culture, spiritual, religious, monastic culture. And this is what helps us with our continuity fear, okay? And this world has been that much this way quite a bit throughout history, quite a bit this way, with quite a bit of success in those dropping their valuing. Which you don't hear about anymore in this world. So the world has been this way to greater or lesser extent, sometimes more, sometimes less. Could have been better for sure. But now, this is what's under attack. This is what's being undermined in the world by those who are so unrepentant and therefore extremely fearful. And that those who want equal confusion as their salvation. Okay, equal confusion, attachment to structure, believing structure is their reality. This is what they want. So they're trying to get rid of this monastic culture, devaluing it, termiting it, actually. They're termiting it. They've termited it to an extraordinary extent. So earth-shaking events collapse into compliance here, collapse into compliance. And you've got a situation right now where some of the key leaders in the world, I would say probably almost all of the key leaders, maybe not all, but most all of the key leaders in the world of institutions, of those who have very pivotal roles of leadership in the world, okay, where people look to them for guidance, okay, and what their will should be like, where they are themselves, you know, very big termites, and their position, their ideological position is to collapse us, the world, into compliance. So you have the ones that are holding the puppet strings, as it were, of the planet. They want to collapse the world into compliance. So that is not a, you know, beneficial situation. It's not a very optimistic situation. I'm not optimistic about the near-term future of this planet at all. Not optimistic about it. Long term, difficult to say. What I was shown is this planet is going to go through a lot of changes long term, and we won't even recognize it long term, actually. But let's stick with the short term here. Let's stick with the short term. Now, what do we have to do? We have to get to what I call the open gate. The gate is open. The gate is open. This is what. Something like I experienced. The gate is open. The gate is open to no structure. Wow, my gate is open. Now, this is very important, pivotal. There's one step beyond gate is openness. Okay, what is that? There is no gate. There's never been a gate. This is too far beyond what we can do to make it our objective. Because if we, when we realize that there is no gate, there's never been any gate, we would not, Jesus tells us, we wouldn't stay here very long. We wouldn't be able to keep even an appearance here very long. So this is not the goal. To realize there is no gate is not our goal. Our goal is to recognize the gate is open. The gate is open. It's not locked. It's open. This is a huge wow. This is a way of referring to what I experienced. The gate is open. Wow. This is the goal. This is the goal here. Now, the intellect's very tricky. And it will say, oh, that's great. They reach the gate is open, that's great. And the intellect will say, but you know, there's one step beyond that. And the intellect will one-up you. Which is why I say full stop in the wow is so important. And to not go into intellectual gamesmanship and one-upsmanship, say, yeah, this is great, but there's another step beyond that. And that will then get you out of your focusing your will on, hey, the gate is open, which is just an extraordinary realization, which will absolutely change your You know, heal your perception. It's called healed perception. That is healed perception. Seeing the gate is open is healed perception. No gate at all is dropping all perception altogether. And you can't really function very well here with that. And Jesus says, no, forget it. That's not your goal here. Your goal is healed perception. Okay. The intellect, trying to avoid healed perception, will try to use spiritual gamesmanship on you. And tell you, no, oh, there's another step beyond this, and, you know, yeah, but this isn't really worth it, full stopping right now, come on, keep going. No, full stop in, the gate is open, that is the goal, that is the full stop that we're looking for. This is very crucial, because you will find that the intellect will pretend to be all spiritual, but its goal is to say, no, skip or just go past this, the gate is open. Say, it's nice, but come on, keep going. And it'll frighten you so bad, you'll have a reaction formation, and then you will actually start trying to wrap yourself in some sort of structure, and you'll start going into confusion and more fear, and you will end up collapsing into compliance as well. So, let's be very clear that our goal is the gate is open. The gate is open. And that's what I saw, essentially. The gate is open. Wow. Now, did I unlock it? Well, what I unlocked was my willingness to see, to recognize it is open. It's always been open. It's never been locked. I just desired it to be locked, you know. Because I hope it's locked. I hope it's locked. Out of fear. I need structure. I need the gate closed, you know. And then letting go of that. Now I saw, oh my gosh, it's open. The gate is open. Now, this is a real stunner. And that's what I experienced just last night on the evening of the 17th of December, 2014. If you want to put some structure on it, which we don't need to, but we're not trying to attack the belief in structure. We're just trying to gently set it down, is all. And just saying this, the gate is open, wow, just a feeling, just a tremendous wow. Watching the mind, how it's trying to trick back into structure, right? Belief into structure. How did you open the gate? You know, what did you do? Now it's open. It's just open. That's all. You need to just get used to the fact. Just the fact. It's open. That's it. It's open. I don't need to how this, how that, etc. No, it's open. I need to get over the stunning truth of this fact that it's open. This leads to healed perception. When it was accepted, the gate is open, then this is what heals our perception. Being willing to perceive this fully is healed perception. And there isn't too much intellectualism about it, really. It's a deeper thing than that. So be careful that your goal is not a conceptual conclusion, but rather it's an experience. And this is very crucial. This is what Jesus is emphasizing. So important. Make sure your destination is not a conceptual destination, but rather experiencing, which is wow, which is why you need to practice full stop in the wow. Practice it. And then you won't need the conceptual destination anymore. You don't need to reach it. Now, what is the difficulty? Well, of course, the mind tries to to wrap it up in structure for you. You know, you have to say no to that. So it's an interesting challenge. It's a fun challenge, actually. And we should teach our children and everyone in the culture how fun this challenge is, how enjoyable it is, actually, and how it's a righteous challenge. You know, it may require our discipline and our will. It certainly does. And we may be stunned and a little bit shocked and fatigued, but in a monastic-based culture, everyone accepts this. They repent and say, this is great. You know, this is, I mean, right now in our culture, people are practicing to run marathons all the time. Is that fun? And they say it is, but it wears and tears. It's fatiguing and difficult, right? But aches and pains, and they say, oh, it's fine, it's great, I love it. Well, in a monastic culture, people will take on this goal of open gateness, wowness, practicing this, and say, yeah, it's tough, but we love it. This is fun. Just like that. Now, I'm not advocating in these videos either position of a political right or the political left. They're two sides of one lie, actually. One coin of a lie has how many sides? Two sides, right? There is the same lie, which is they're just arguing over which structure to wrap the identity up in. You know, they disagree over what the packaging should be like. And we're saying no packaging, actually. We're getting to no packaging. Okay? It's very different. So I'm not an advocate of the right's position or the left's position, okay? The conservatives, the progressives, whatever you want to call it. But I most certainly am an advocate of spiritual literacy. And what I see very clearly is there are those that identify with what we call the left, progressives, communists, etc., who are most definitely trying to collapse the world into compliance with equal confusion. Let's all share equal confusion and call it good. Say, okay, that's it. We're finished. So most certainly point that out. But that does not mean that ideologically I'm on the right. You say, no, I'm not on the right. Well, at least political right. And then the truth of the fact that we have a continuity fear. Okay. And the goal is ultimately no structure, but the goal is healed perception. Healed perception, which is the gate is open. The gate to no structure is open. Just see, just accept this experience of the gate to no structure is open. Here on earth, as we're identifying with bodies in this world, the gate to recognizing no structure is open. It's actually open for us. This is the goal, to accept this. And this is the goal that many in this world, including on the right, okay, yeah, because they say, no, we got structure, you know, we know what the right structure is. And those on the left say, no, we know what the right structure is, and then they fight. So I'm not in that fight. I don't have a dog in that fight at all. Not at all. I don't even have a dog. Okay. Not even. So, got God, okay, which is no structure. So the gate is open. The gate is open. As an experience, as a feeling, not as a conceptual conclusion. Now, there's nothing wrong with conceptual conclusions as long as it yields to the feeling and the experience. Don't make an idol of conceptual conclusions. It's very important. Don't grow your intellect into an elephant, okay? Which is a problem that many have. Then that gets clumsy, it just gets unwieldy. Just practice experiencing. You don't need the conceptual structure. You're experiencing more directly. The gate is open. The gate is open. Now, when you see the gate is open, you're not focusing on the gate. You're focusing on the openness, right? So you're not saying, what is the structure of the gate? You know, it's interesting ironwork on this gate, you know, interesting designs and patterns on the gate. No, you're just saying, hey, this gate, I don't care what the structure appears to be of this gate. What I'm focused on is it's open. It's not, I am not imprisoned by this gate. It's open. I thought it was locked. No, it's open. It means I can go through. I can go through, or what is beyond the gate can go through to me too, right? Which is no structure, freedom from structure. So don't fixate on the gate. fixate on, focus on the openness. Don't fixate on the gate, focus on the openness. The gate is open. And you don't need to say, well, how much is it open? No, it's open. That's the only thing that matters. It is open. We don't need to take any measurements. We don't need to attach any concepts to it. Just simple, full stop. Gate is open, full stop. Then, what is the feeling of that? What is the feeling of a gate being open? Is what we should say, okay, what is the feeling? Not conceptually, but just full stop. Gate is open. And I woke up at 4 in the morning, and for hours and hours and hours and hours I was, well, until I got up, focusing on trying to full stop. You know, the mind kept trying to come in. It kept, no, no, no. So you know, you give it hour after hour after hour of effort for sure. Sometimes waking up early in the morning, this is the best time to give the full effort, right? Because you have nothing else to do. You don't want to get up. It's cold. It's dark. You just meditate. You know, use your attention. Focus your attention. Full stop in the wow. Wow, the gate is open. And there's nothing I need to do to keep it open. It's inherently open. I've seen it's inherently open. There's nothing I need to do to keep it open or sustain the openness. Nothing I need to do to open it. Nothing I need to do to sustain the openness of the gate. It is just, the gate is open. That's it. It's an open gate. Don't let your mind play with any concepts about openness, okay? Just feel. What does this mean? The gate is open. You know, this is it. This is openness to heal perception. And you know, the more you just get used to this feeling, this wowness, it will begin to transfer and generalize. It will be generalized, 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 and you will begin to take the necessary steps in progress that you'll be easy. You'll see it. Oh, of course, of course, of course. Yeah, I can do this now. You'll make vastly more progress than any sort of conceptuality can ever attain, that is for sure. Conceptuality can only point to, it can't ever actually be the progress, be the experience. It can only point. It's pointing to the points of experience, but we have to have the experience, the feeling of this. Gate is open. And there's no going back. It's open. So I just have to get used to this fact. It's open. So full stop in the wow is like, hey, I have no choice but to get used to this fact. So I have to use my will and make sure my attention is on this. It doesn't wander off. Full stop in the wow of the gate is open. This is spiritual practice. Full stop in the wow of the gate is open. There's not a bunch of mystery to it. No mystery to it. It's just your attention, your spiritual will, your attention, and the feeling. The wow feeling, like, wow, the gate is open. Structure is not a closed gate. Here's another example. It's like a chain. Take a chain with all these closed links of a chain, right? Look at the chain again and you suddenly see, oh my gosh, all the links are actually open. They're not welded, closed at all. In every single chain link in this chain. You actually see, it's you know, it's not closed like this. It's open. So you can none of the links in the chain are actually locked into another link whatsoever. This is freedom. Okay. You still see a chain, right? Healed perception still sees a chain, but it sees now that none of the links are welded shut at all. And you can disengage any of these links with any other link this very instant without any effort whatsoever, really. Okay? This is an example of healed perception. This is a way of looking at healed perception. The links of the chains, we say, oh, yeah, there's a chain. Now, we're not saying, oh, there's no chain. We're saying, yeah, I see a chain, but I see that all the links are open. Every single one without exception. So I'm not bound by that chain at all, actually. I can still be wearing the chain of this body, but I'm not bound by it in the slightest bit. I could still be wearing the chains of this world, but I realize I'm not bound by it at all. Not at all. Effortlessly, not bound by it. The gate is open. I'm not trapped. I don't have to walk through the gate right now. I can just sit here and just say, realize, wow, I'm not trapped at all. I'm not trapped at all. Well, that was a fortuitous stopping of the video, because while the video was stopped taking a phone call, a car alarm went off. The car was honking, honk, honk, over and over and over and over and over. It's a nice sidestepping of that, right? So heed the call to the gate is open, full stop in the wow. Practice full stop in the wow. You may not have this experience that the gate is open right away. It's taken a lifetime for me to get to this point. But I've had many, 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 many little glimpses of this. The gate is open, little, but this is a more profound one. Little, just, you know, it's like real quick, and it fades, like it seems to fade, but it leaves its impression of wow. It's like a shooting star, you know, phew. Yeah, did I see it? Yeah, I think so. But it's gone so fast, you know, you hardly... And this is like a huge, you know, comet going across the sky, so to speak. It's just like, wow. Yeah, like that. It lasted, you know, a long time. It's like, I mean, it really was really strong. So these little glimpses help enable us to practice the feeling of this, wow, gate is open. Structure. I'm not imprisoned by the belief in structure at all. The chain links are open. The links in the chain are open. They're not welded shut. I really am free. I see my freedom, but the gate's still there. So I still feel, you know, like a little bit of structure, but I see it's open. Let's say I drink in the Red Bull, okay, and what would happen? Well, it would stimulate thinking, and what would happen was I would have probably got into some sort of structuring, more, you know, structuring instead of full stop. I'd say, hey, you know, how can I structure this breakthrough I've had? You know, what can I do about this? And start brainstorming about it, you know. Not good, not good. Instead, I've done nothing about it. Just continue to feel this. But again, I don't want to give specifics like exactly what happened, because people can easily fixate and say, okay, that's what I need to do. No, it will happen organically when you're ready for it. Somehow you'll have this inner desire, like, hey, I really want to make a breakthrough here, and somehow you'll come across something which will trigger it for you. But each one is you know, different, slightly different this way or that way. You cannot dictate specifically, you know, this is exactly, if you just, you know, this is it for you or something, not necessarily. And you don't want to have a conceptual goal in that way. That will mess you up. So I'm just feeling this is still with me entirely. Something very profound happened, which is not unexpected. I expected it to happen. I expected something to happen. I don't know what. I didn't have a real conceptual framework or structure. I try to stay away from defining what you think must happen as far as, you know, a breakthrough, so to speak. Don't try to say, well, exactly what is, you know, what is the experience that I'm looking for, in structurally, definitionally. Just say no. Just keep practicing, and when you're enough practice, it will come. It will come. The way they say it is when the devotee is ready, the guru appears. It's a way of saying when your practicing has been sufficient, the breakthrough occurs. There's a better way of saying it, really, or at least just as good as a way, referring to the same situation. Now, it could very well be a guru. It appears you get some help from a guru. Absolutely. It doesn't have to be that way. It doesn't have to be. So don't conceptualize. Don't say, well, this is how it must occur. This is it. This is the only way. It has to occur this way. No. Because the gate, you can see the open gate. You can recognize it. Wherever you are, in any situation, if you're ready, somehow you will catch a glimpse and realize, the gate is open. The gate is open. In fact, the way it happened, I didn't expect it to happen. It was unexpected. Unexpected, very unexpected. So somehow the deep, some sort of deep dissolving of structuring, so somehow it's taking place where the fact that the gate is open is sort of like percolated through to the surface consciousness in some way. Whereas deep down we all know the gate's open deep down spiritually, but there seems to be a lot of confusion about it in more superficial consciousness, right? So the idea is to let this awareness arise all the way to surface consciousness. More and more. So of course when it surfaces, it's like, wow. But we say, well, I was expecting you. In terms of somehow it's going to surface somehow. Don't know where. It's like a big ocean. You don't know where the submarine's going to surface, but you know it's going to surface somewhere. This is pretty much the way to look at it. It's looking out across this expansive ocean, and you feel like, you know what? I feel like the submarine is going to surface, break the surface somewhere. I really feel this way. So you like search looking. Now just keep your awareness just diffused, just so you're looking out of the ocean, and you say, when it surfaces, I'll see it. I don't know where it's going to be. I'm not trying to determine where it's going to be. I'm just practicing, so when it does surface, I'll say, great, okay. That's great, I'm fine. So this is a way of looking at it. Don't fixate on any particular place of the ocean. Say, it must surface in this area, or this area of the ocean, over here, there. Just say, I know somewhere in this ocean, I'm going to see a submarine is going to rise up from the depths and surface, and I'll see it. I'm focused on practicing, full stop on the wow. I'm not trying to outsmart myself by trying to determine where exactly it's going to surface. Okay, I'm not focused, my thinking's not focused on that. I just, somewhere, it will surface. That's it. Now practice. Someday it will surface, somewhere it will surface. But the feeling I've had is that, of course, I can feel it's going to surface. I know it will surface. So, just keep practicing. Absolutely, all the indications have been there. So many indications that it's surfacing. It's coming to surface. So okay, just don't worry about where, when, or where. Not important. It doesn't matter what the gate looks like. Only matters that the gate is open, and you realize that. Doesn't matter how much it's open, an unlocked gate is an unlocked gate. You know, it's an unlocked gate. There's nothing keeping it, nothing locking at all. That's what's important. Now, at first it may seem like it's just open a little bit. That's fine. It's still unlocked. Once you get used to that, it's easy to swing it all, you know, wide open. To say, hey, it's wide open. But the crucial step is to realize the gate is unlocked. It's absolutely unlocked. That's the crucial step. Don't worry that about how wide open it is at all, because that's a very minor thing, isn't it? Very minor. Don't let the intellect trick you into that. It's minor, very minor. It's like you're withdrawing from a precipice and you step 10 feet back from the precipice and you sit down and realize, wow, I was on the brink of falling into that precipice, and now I realize I'm safe from it, you see. Now, after a while of getting over the shock of this, you'll get up and you'll go far, far away from that precipice, right? But the important thing is that you're safe from the precipice. So there's another way of looking at it, but that's sort of like a more fearful way of addressing it. But it's open, the gate is not locked. That's the main thing. If you come to a gate and you think it's going to be locked, and you think it's all important to get past that gate, and you push and realize, oh, it's open, it's not locked, what do? You throw it open, run through, say, oh, you know, you actually say, oh, wow. You take a moment and you say, wow, this is great. I feared it would be locked. I couldn't make good through it. I was expecting, you know, troubles, and no troubles now. And then what happens? Continuity problem, right? Because you structured a scenario of problems for you. You think, well, A, it's going to be locked. B, I can't get through. C, how can I live my life without getting through the gate? D, how many much more efforts, what kind of efforts do I need to take to get the gate unlocked? You know, and who do I need to, you know, get help I need to get? How long is it going to take? All this stuff is structured in your expectations. And when you come and push the gate and say, oh my gosh, it's open. Nothing I need to do. So, you know, just go through. It's open. A, B, C, D, and all the other letters. Poof. No need for them. So you take a moment and say, wow, my future just radically changed now. This is what I'm feeling, and it is definitely shock, you know. Wow, my future just radically changed. Don't need A, don't need B, don't need C, D, E, F, or whatever, G. Don't need any of that. Gate's open. I can go through. It's no problem at all. So I can say experientially here that is a tremendous shock, even though conceptually we're hoping for it. In the back of our minds, we're worried that maybe it is locked. And so we have all these projections of expectations of how am I going to deal with this, and then those suddenly just evaporate. And you realize it's not locked, it's just they all evaporate. And so this is why we call it, because you don't have to go through all those steps. It's totally unnecessary now. Don't need to find a locksmith, right? Don't need to pay the locksmith. Don't need to work to get the money to pay the locksmith. You know, don't, you know, on and on and on and on. Don't need to structure your life looking for the locksmith, trying to earn the money. You don't need to structure, you know, all of that. The whole life is wrapped up in finding that locksmith. If you can find him, you can't even find him. Searching, searching, searching. Now you realize, don't need a locksmith at all. Don't need a life wrapped up in trying to find the locksmith. So as you can imagine, this is a very radical experiencing. Future lives just vanished. No need for them. And this is just not something conceptual. This is something I'm experiencing, feeling. There's no need for them. And I know it's true. It's like, wow. I don't ever have to look for a locksmith. I mean, you can look for a locksmith life after life after life after life after life. Hire so many locksmiths and they all say, I can't figure this one out, you know. Of course they can't figure it out because there's nothing to pick. There's no lock to pick. It's open. So every locksmith comes back and tells you, I couldn't do it. They couldn't figure this one out. It's real tricky. So, well, the trick is there is no lock. It's open. So, you don't need to spend all these lives, cycles of lives, looking for the, trying to find that lucky locksmith. You know, trying to find the lucky locksmith. Some locksmiths will tell you, I opened it for you. Okay, give them, where's the money? I opened it for you. And you say, really? Great, how'd you do it? Locke says, well, I can't tell you. It's a secret. Well, what do you mean? What do you mean it's a secret? You know, I need to know this. It's really important. No, I can't really tell you. Of course, they didn't open it because it's already open. There's no lock. And they're just, you know, just how you trick yourselves. Get the tricky locksmith there. Says, yeah, I opened it. No, they didn't. Any locksmith says they opened the gate is lying. There is no lock. It's open. No lock to pick. So this is generating just an intense spiritual buzz. But on the surface, of course, I'm functioning fine. Everything is fine. Breathing is fine. Digestion is fine. You know, movement is fine. Seeing, hearing, whatever. Everything's fine. But in terms of psyche-wise, psychology psyche-wise, feeling-wise, it's like my future lives just, you know, disappeared, so to speak. I sort of gradually realizing this, you know, just not only future lives, but the future of this life is, you know, changed. Don't need to spend it looking for a locksmith, wrapping the future of this life, or just my future at all, or just now at all, wrapping now into a structure of what we call a future, a structure that we explore of trying to find a locksmith. Don't need to. Try to make this experience enjoyable, full stop, in the way. I don't try to make it anything. Just stay with it. survival structure, but forgive yourself for doing so, and then let it go. You say, okay, I forgive myself for that. I don't really need that. Let me get back to this wildness, which is what I've done during working today. You know, wrapped up a little bit of structure, but pretty much, you know, full stop. When I saw a storyline, a structure being, you know, concocted by the mind, I just said, I don't need to find out what that structure turns out to be like. Let me just drop it right now. It's like you're working on a sculpture, and I said, knock the sculpture. I don't need it to know how that sculpture turns out. I'm not interested in it. Instead of having the sculpture turn out to be something and looking at it, say, you know, I think, why don't we change how it looks? I want to change how it looks a little bit. This isn't quite what I want. And I just said, I don't care how it turns out. I don't want it. Don't need it. So, you know, push the sculpture stone over. Stop working on the sculpture. Use that for your thoughts and your train of thoughts and your storylines and the structuring you're trying to wrap this up in. Just say, don't need that. I don't care how it turns out. One way or the other, that makes no difference. I'm just going to drop it right now. You're reading a book and you go halfway through it and say, I don't want to spend my time this way. Just drop the book. I don't care how it turns out. It doesn't matter to me. Because the fact is, the gate is open. Is the truth. That is the truth. That's how all stories ultimately end up. So I already know the ending of the story. The gate is open. So all this structure, the minds, the stories that the mind are telling you, saying you need to go on this trip. You say, no, I don't need to go on that trip. I've already arrived at the end of the trip. Gate is open. That is the end of the trip. And I need to go back on that long, strange trip I've been on to figure out how I open the gate. The gate's always been open. There was no opening of the gate. It's just a realization. It's open. So all the long, strange trip was just a delay. Is all. That's all it was. If you could put every single book ever published down right now, every movie down right now, every story down right now, every lifetime down right now, and just say, I know how it ends. It all ends exactly the same. And I'm here at the end of all of that, which is the gate is open. That is the end of all of that. All of it ends up with this realization. The gate is open. That's it. Destination for everyone. Everyone arrives at this destination and the gate is open. You want to arrive sooner? Practice full stop in the well. You want to delay your arrival and keep traveling all over the place and have all these adventures, misadventures, etc.? Then don't practice full stop in the well. Just like the top of the mountain, all paths end up the mountain, end up ultimately at the top of the mountain, whatever which way you know, get up, go to the top. All roads lead to realization that the gate is open. We keep thinking we have to follow this long path, you know, getting to the gate, that open gate, you know. But if we just slow down a full stop in the wow, we realize we're right here, and right in front of us, the gate is open. All this wandering around is just in our mind. It's just, you know, we're not going anywhere, actually. The fact of the truth is right here, right now, this instant. Wandering around a path doesn't open the gate. It's already open. It's just What causes our wandering? Our continuity fear causes our wandering. So practice full stop in the wow of little glimpses of no structure, getting past structure, any holy instance. Jesus calls them holy instance, little glimpses. And you become, realize, hey, I don't need to keep wandering around on some path, waiting for the gate to open or trying to figure out how to open it. It's already open. The gate is open, it's always been open. You may think, hey, I need to write a song about this or something. No, it's way more profound than that. You're talking about, you finished the path. You don't need any more lifetimes. You don't need any more adventure, misadventures in delusion. And, you know, this is something way beyond, hey, let me compose a little ditty, you know, about this. Like, hey, I came to the end of the path and it's so nice and da-da-da-da. No. It's way more profound than that. It doesn't lend itself to that sort of activity. This is the dawning of you know, glory. Yeah, really. Absolute glory, absolute freedom. This is the dawning. You can see the dawn. Gate is open. I can see the dawn. Yeah. This doesn't lend itself to being expressed in words, really. Or actions, or anything, you know, music, expression. It doesn't lend itself to that, really. So much more, so much better than that. So don't wrap it up in that. Don't wrap it up in that structure of a song, of music, poetry, whatever. That's all structure. It's all conceptual structure. Leave it unwrapped. Gate is open. Leave it unwrapped, the situation. I'm starting to get a little tired, starting to wrap up, starting to put some structure into it there. It's like, wow, just stop it, you know. Again, going for the Red Bull means you're getting too frightened of it. You say, I need to really wrap this up in a really intense structure. So let me get going on that because I'm feeling too frightened of it. No, don't do that. You have to just, you know, rest, take it easy, don't do anything creative. Just be, as I say, a nobody from nowhere. Being conceptually creative, artistically creative is the booby prize, very much the booby prize. So don't think that you'll be judged lesser for lacking to do that. Just the opposite. Those who forego that and say, no, that's the booby prize. You know, that is recognized like that's very wise. And the progress will be much greater because of it. And this is a gradual thing. I mean, just gradually maybe cut back on it. It's a battle, it's a struggle. I struggle with that thing. Wow, I feel so inspired that I feel so shocked that maybe I can like give some sort of expression, new expression from this shock. This is like some profound shock and so some profound way. Maybe I can, you know, do some new style of painting or, you know, music or something. No, don't do that. That puts you on a very delaying side trip. Don't wrap it up in any structure. Just experience the shock, staggered mindness. So I just kind of waste time. Don't get stuck in anything that seems to fire your imaginations. Oh yeah, I gotta do this now. You know, don't start sculpting and don't start composing. You know, don't, because then you'll start getting pulled into that, thinking, wow, I could do this and I can do this and I can, hey, then, you know, and then your excitation, you know, your fear gets turned into this excitation of trying to express with form, define the indefinable. Just let it be without any definition. Let it be unwrapped, unpackaged, no packaging, no definition. Absolute freedom. No structure. Just let it be free of any structure as much as possible. Again, and looking out at the ocean, say, I know it's going to surface soon. It's okay. Wherever it surfaces is equally okay with me. I'm not trying to pick any preference of where it surfaces. Doesn't matter where it surfaces. Just let, you know, just let it surface. That's all that matters. Just let it surface. The gate is open, very great. That is it.